Well, last week we began a four-week series on Jonah, and I've encouraged you, if you haven't, please go back and read all those four chapters, a time or two, listen to it, whatever your mode is. Very helpful, and let the Lord speak to you. So practical. So last week I told you about, I was trying to have Joel find a song, but he couldn't get in my passcodes on my phone. Now he can. I was going to call it out publicly, but I thought that'd be a mistake, wouldn't it, nowadays? But I was reminded of this song that kind of illustrates, because I thought there was a verse. My friend and I, Jim and I, my mom, you know, we'd make us like shirts alike, and we'd sing at talent competitions and things like that, and we sang the Hornets song. And it's hilarious, because you'll hear the lyrics in a moment, but one of the times we sang it at church, we had a renowned Bible scholar there that was holding services. His name was Dr. Ralph Earl, I should say. And he was one of the original NIV translators that brought us that edition. And after we sang this song, he goes, "Well, I don't know how theologically correct this song is, but we get it anyway." Okay, so here's what it said. So it's called the Hornet Song. So this kind of sets the context. Verse one was, if a nest of live hornets were brought to this room and the creatures allowed to go free, you would not need urging to make yourself scarce. You'd want to get out, don't you see? Has anybody heard this hit song before? I mean, it was big back in the 60s. This was before the hippie generation even. They would not lay hold and by force of their strength throw you out of the window. Oh, no. They would not compel you to go against your will, but they just make you willing to go. But in the archives of my mind, I was thinking for a Jonah verse, and here it is. When Jonah was sent to the work of the Lord, the outlook was not very bright. He never had done such a hard thing before, so he backed and ran off from the fight. But God sent a big fish to swallow him up. That's the phrase I remembered. The story I'm sure you've all or may know, he did not compel him to go against his will, but he just made him willing to go. And the chorus or bridge said this: he does not compel us to go. No, no. He does not compel us to go. He does not compel us to go against our will, but he just makes us willing to go. I think that's pretty good theology. Has the Lord ever compelled you to go? He doesn't force you, but he changes our will power, does he not? So none of you have ever heard that song before. Oh, Dixie and I should have sung it. She wouldn't. She thinks it's too cheesy to sing, but I would. Well, we started out in chapter 1 where it says that the Lord gave this message to Jonah: get up and go to the great city of Nineveh, announce my judgment against it, because I have seen how wicked its people are. So we began to investigate the life and times of Jonah, and we dug into it, and we realized that there's a reason. It's just like he didn't, I don't want to go there. But when the Bible says they were a wicked people, if you look it up and do Bible study on it, you can find out how wicked they were and the horrible things they were engaged in. And he didn't want to do it. So it's not just, I thought originally, I had in my notes, he probably hated those people, but I don't know if that's the key. I think he was afraid of them. I mean, it was notorious. Remember, cities would commit mass suicide if they heard that they were going to attack them, the Assyrians, and he was afraid. And how many of you know that many times our fear comes out in anger? Would that be true? We lash out. So here's his response in verse 3. Jonah got up. Well, he got the first part right. The Lord said, get up. Jonah got that right, didn't he? Did you see that? But he went in the opposite direction to get away from the Lord. And then it goes on to say that he found a ship heading in the opposite direction. But the last of that verse says, hoping to escape from the Lord by sailing to Tarshish. Has anybody tried to futilely outrun the Lord? Have you tried to go someplace he is not already there? How do you have found that when you get there, he's already been there? He is there. He is wherever you are. But God, in his great redemptive love, his compelling force that we sang about, didn't let him off so easy. His stubborn love pursued Jonah. Has his stubborn love ever been unleashed on you? No matter where. In the old days, when I was growing up, the evangelists would call it the hounds of heaven. Anybody ever hear that one? But that's really a picture of God's stubborn love. So we went through the story. God sent a huge storm, and it really interrupted his trip, and he learned he couldn't outrun and hide. He knew better anyway. The ship's captain approached Jonah and said, "Who are you and what are you doing?" He was a man of God, and but he wasn't praying at that time. He was kind of in a distant relationship. He was prayerless and powerless, if you will. I don't know if you've found it, but typically running away from God and praying at the same time, that doesn't usually go together too well, does it? Prayer, the power of prayer. We're gonna look at Jonah's prayer in just a little bit. I came across this story that a pastor and his congregation in a small community were upset because there was a bar opening right adjacent to their location. So they decided they were going to do something about it. So they began to announce that they were going to pray this bar out of business. They even held a prayer vigil or two specifically aimed to that end. Well, would you believe it that sometime during that vigil, lightning struck the bar and it actually burned to the ground while several members were in there imbibing from the church? Just kidding about that part. It happened. The bar owner decided to take them to court and sue the church. The judge listened to the arguments. The bar owner said, it was the pastor and people's fault. They prayed, and because of their prayers, my bar was struck by lightning. The pastor protested, oh, no, 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 it's not our fault. Our harmless little prayers don't usually get answered. It's just what we do. It's not our fault that God did this thing. We didn't think anything like this could ever possibly happen. The judge sat there stroking his chin, and there was silence, and then finally he said, well, this is very interesting. I find this very interesting. Here we have a bar owner that believes in the power of prayer, and we have a pastor who does not. That's kind of where Jonah was, man of God, but he evidently, the pagan sailors and captain, they believed in the power of prayer more than he did. Pray to our God and have him call off the storm. But he wasn't in the mood to pray because distance always diminishes that. But again, as we said last week, he finally admitted who he was. We talked about that. And what he was doing on their ship, running away and away from God. So he suggested, remember, that they get rid of him. He said, it's my problem, it's my fault. If you throw me overboard, the seas will calm. The sailors didn't want to do that. They valiantly tried to save the ship to no avail. And finally, they did that. And God sent, as I just read in the words, the lyrics of the song, sent a great fish to swallow him up. And I guarantee you that the next 3 days and nights were the longest he had ever spent in his life. And I just wondered, I'm doing parallels as I'm thinking about Jonah's story. It's relevant, it's applicable to us, to where we live. And I just want to ask you, what's your belly of the whale story, or the belly of a great fish story? Where did God finally get your attention? That's what happened here. He was like the prodigal son, running as fast as he could, but in desperation, in that dark, damp, what unbelievable place, ungodly place, he came to his senses and he began to pray. And the distance between he and God, how many of you believe that God was there in the stomach or whatever of that great fish? He was. He was. Isn't that where many of us begin to pray? The busyness stops, life comes to a screeching halt, something unexpected happens, and all of a sudden we're confronted and it's just God and us. That may be what it takes to get our attention. I said maybe first week or so, I talked about maybe whatever it takes to get our attention kind of prayers. And it's maybe even harder to pray that for people we love, saying, Lord, whatever it takes to get their attention, I'm praying into that. If you go back and as you read through this or listen to Jonah's prayer, it's almost like reading one of David's Psalms. It's beautiful. As this runaway prophet, man of God, who had neglected God in the relationship, began to cry out to God in prayer. And how many of you know that God just stopped his ears and said, no, I'm not listening. No, what did he do? It said he heard his prayer from that dark and desolate place. Is that encouraging to you? No. Could your place get much more desolate than the belly of a fish underneath the deep? But in that place, I mean, can you imagine him? It must have been cavernous and echoing in there. But somehow God heard his prayer from this servant who was on the run, who knew better, who heard God say go, but he said no. He met him in this unlikely place. And I alluded to the fact in the story, you'll see that evangelism happened because of their fear of the God, small g, when they threw into Jonah overboard and the seas immediately calmed. They were in awe and they made a vow that they were going to worship God. They offered a sacrifice to him. God always shows up and does unlikely things. So here we have it in Jonah 2, verses 1 and 2. So in that dark place, I'm adding, now Jonah prayed to the Lord his God from inside the fish. Can you just imagine how that must have smelled in there? Yeah, I think that's where sushi got its start. It just occurred to me. I think if you were in the belly of that great fish, you might never eat sushi again. I'm not sure. But he said in verse 2, these things come to mind. I often find myself chuckling when I read God's word because they're just things that strike me really funny. Do you ever have those moments, or is it just, am I strange? I cried out to the Lord in my great trouble, and he answered me. I called to you from the land of the dead, and Lord, you heard me. Boy, that ought to be an encouragement to us, no matter who you are or where you are. I cried out to the Lord in my great trouble. I've got news for you. That's where evangelism typically happens, when people are in the middle of a life change or in some kind of great trouble. God uses that, whether he caused it or not, we can't always say, but he uses it to get our attention, does he not? To call us to quit looking around and looking within or looking down, but he's calling us to look up and know that the Lord, he is God. So I wonder, don't you, in my mind's eye, what this prayer must have sounded like. I mean, in my mind, it probably was like this. Oh God, help, help. I said he did the Peter. Remember when Peter began to sing, Jesus, save me. He didn't know about Jesus, but God, help me. It's me, Jonah. Save me, help me. God heard him and answered him when he had his full attention. And it's interesting, isn't it, that in this deep trouble, in the deep of the deep, that's where Jonah's prayer life reemerged. Isn't that the same for us at times? The best thing you and I and we can do in our distress is to call on the name of the Lord. We used to do choir tours when I was a youth pastor. We'd travel all over the eastern side of the country, and one of the songs we sang from the Brooklyn Tab was the name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run into it and they are saved. I mean, call out the name of the Lord. You see, the names of the Lord are his character. It's who he is. It's what he does. Wow. Call on the one who's the source of all things, the one who created all that is. He is the one who is all everything, present, powerful, knowing, loving, forgiving, forgetting, you name it. That's in the name of the Lord. Even though Jonah had blatantly said, basically, forget you, Lord, when he cried out, God responded, great in his mercy and grace. Here's the message of hope. If he would do that for him, he'll do that for you and yours. I don't know what the rescue operation will be like. It may not be as you pray, as you expect, but he is active and he's present and he hears your cry. God does answer when we sincerely cry out to him from the depths of our heart. I don't know about you, but I quite often observe something like this. When things get bad and people are just at the wit's end and they don't know what to do, I hear this well-intentioned, and I've heard this statement over and over, especially around churches where I've grown up. I guess all I can do now, all we can do now is pray. What's wrong with that statement? That's the problem. If Jonah would have started praying ahead of time, he may have never ended up in the belly of the fish. Oh, I guess, couldn't you just hear Eeyore saying that? I guess all we can do is pray. We've done it before, didn't work. Oh my, have a bad day. Don't like that. I've got news for you. Prayer is not the last resort, it's our first option. That's why you see the badges. That's why I emphasize right now, pray now. When's the best time to pray? Oh, I shoulda, coulda. Oh, I will. No, the best time to pray is right now. Right now. Pray early, pray often, pray now. Hebrews 4:16 tells it, so let us come boldly, and I put scratch in the margin, often if you need to the throne of our gracious God. There you will receive mercy and will find grace to help us when we need it most. Always available. You can never use it up. It's not our last resort. Pray now about anything, about everything. You know how we're learning to do that in this congregation? By doing it, aren't we? We're practicing it. I look for opportunities to pray with you. I pray for you during the week, and I prayed for many of you by name as you've come to mind and heart, but I love to put my arm around your shoulder and pray with you. Because I hear things like this. It seems that people are afraid to say to people, it might be politically incorrect, to pray something like, can I pray with you or for you right now? Now we water it down. I know you're going through a hard time. I just want you to know I'll be thinking about you. I don't want you just thinking about me. I want you praying for me. How about you? Praying together is so powerful. Pray for me. Pray with me right now. Jonah's distress was great. Oh, by the way, it's interesting. I just been watching various sports. I don't care what the sport is on TV. It used to be in old days when they had, you know, somebody's illness or a death, they would say right on the air, oh, you're in our thoughts and prayers. You watch now. Normally they just say, you're in my thoughts. They don't go on to say prayers. Have you noticed that? Oh, we're going to talk about some of these things on July 3rd. I'm just warning you, if you don't want that stuff, go someplace else on the 3rd. I'm revving up for that day, okay? If a Memorial Day bothered you, July 3rd is really going to bother you, okay? Just giving you a heads up. His distress was great. The Bible compares this word to the like an distress and pain of childbirth. But he called in agony in that dark place, and that's precisely when God got his attention. I think we can read the story and we can shrug it off, but we fail to think. And we think about ourselves and we think about our dark place, but Jonah believed he was as good as dead. I mean, he thought he was in the grave. I mean, wouldn't you? Tossed into a raging sea and you were an appetizer for a big fish's meal. He'd never been this far away from God. He was miserable. He had nothing to contribute. He had nothing now to offer to God. He was powerless, helpless, desperate, hurting, afraid. But from the land of the dead, he cried out to God, and God heard him and answered his prayer in that very dark place. That's where some of you feel like you are today. You feel like you're alone. You feel like God is absent. You feel like you're crying out in vain. You don't think you've ever been in such a deep and dark place, but I want to tell you on the assurance of God's word that he is with you and he is hearing the cry of your heart. He wants your attention. I should have said a little bit ago, Jonah had nothing to offer, but he had everything to offer, and that was a gift of himself. Because isn't that what God really wants? That's what he wants in our worship today. He wants us. He doesn't want our words. He wants us. Our words are an expression of our heart. That's what he's looking for. And that calls for sacrifice and surrender. It could be a marriage, it could be work, it could be family, anxiety. I don't know, future that's unknown and uncertain. But Jonah, if he were here, he might say something like this to us today, these encouraging words. I'm just thinking in my mind's eye, when I needed him most, when I deserved him least, he was there for me in the depths. God caused me to be raised from the dead, to be born again. Only dead things can be born again. And I jotted in my margin again that Jesus does resurrections, agreed? That's what God does. In the depths, he cried out. Maybe that's where some were. Maybe that's where you encountered Christ and his love. Maybe that's where some of you are right now, as good as dead. Life seems over. But God can raise you and things and situations to new life. And it's all God, and he gets all the glory. But I warn you, he's going to do it his way, in his time, not yours. And it may be the inverse of what you're trying to pray, the way that you're trying to pray. Let's just cry out to him, help. Let's quit telling him how to do it. And you know what I'm saying? I was thinking this morning, I woke up, the audacity, how many times? I was praying for some of you by name on my heart when I woke up early, and I thought, I got to be careful. I don't want to tell God how to do it. I'm praying for this friend or that friend. I say, I'm sorry, God, just help. I can't do it. Doctors can't do it, but you can. Oh, God, could you move? And then I started praying the Lord's Prayer. Your kingdom come, your will be done. And I don't presume to know always what God's will looks like. Do you? But that doesn't stop me. It doesn't stop us from praying. By the way, resurrections aren't outward in so much as they're inside out. God wants to do his resurrection power on the inside of you. That's where he first began. He used external circumstances to get Jonah's attention, for sure. But he did his best work inside out. And that's what he does for us. As you read the story, why did God allow these lengths to be gone to? I don't know. He could have done it. He could have delivered him any way he saw fit. After God said go and Jonah said no, I mean, everything was turned upside down. But in spite of all the things that we've already rehearsed, the story, there was a slow motion miracle in progress. And God was basically teaching Jonah what he should have known. I want you to do this my way. He responded like us, no, Lord, I'm going to do it my way. But I got to tell you, God chooses to do it his way and not our way, because our ways turn into hot messes. God's not mad. He hasn't tossed you aside. Tossing Jonah overboard wasn't tossing him aside. God was still working a miracle. Would you agree? And we're still talking about it years later. Don't stop looking for the activity of God, even in a storm. Even in the process. Have you ever experienced that God unfolds his plans in phases and stages and spaces? Have you found that to be true? You're finding that to be true? I was thinking back about coming here to be your pastor in 95. I wasn't most of your pastors in 95 because you were nowhere to be seen. Where were you my first Sunday when we showed up to welcome us? You weren't even there. I think Don Doherty told me we had about 167 people, but we had far less the second Sunday. I guess they didn't like what they heard or saw. But as we began to just assess where we were and begin to learn about worship and begin to worship God, you know, we found that God wanted to do something in us before he did something through us and for us. Agreed? Never knew we'd encounter some of the obstacles, the uncertainties, the criticism, the discouragement. We hit roadblocks and detours along the way. But I found that reverse is a really good gear too. Is anybody glad you have reverse on your vehicle? Anybody had reverse go out? That creates quite a problem, doesn't it? But to see how God is working, I never dreamed I'd be pastoring a church like Wooster Naz that's alive and well, not perfect, has a long way to go, but what a blessing. But in those good days and dark days, we found the necessity of just crying out to the Lord, saying, help, help, here we are. We're your people. Have your way. Well, Jonah found himself in the belly of a great fish. I'm getting my words twisted today. Pray for my words, would you? There was no escape. But God finally had his full attention. And he recognized that God's hand and finger had been moving all along. So let me read a few verses. Verse 3. You threw me into the ocean depths, and I sank down to the heart of the sea. I mean, this is a bleak picture. Think about it. The mighty waters engulfed me. I was buried beneath your wild and stormy waves. Then I said, O Lord, you have driven me from your presence, yet I will look once more toward your holy temple. I sank beneath the waves and the waters closed over me. Seaweed wrapped itself around my head. I sank down to the very roots of the mountains and I was imprisoned in the earth whose gates lock and shut forever. But you, O Lord, my God, snatched me from the jaws of death. Wow. Because Jonah did not fall asleep in the depths of the sea because he had not served his purpose in his generation. God still had plans for him. But without God's intervention, his situation was hopeless, going down, down, down. Maybe your life today is spinning and spiraling out of control. Could I encourage you to never forget these but God moments. But God, in his love and mercy, saw you at the point of your need. But God heard his cry from the depths of the sea. But God heard my cry from the depths of anxiety and despair. Some of you, like me, can testify that our marriage seemed like it was over, but God stepped in. The doctor said this, but God did this. The God who said, "Is there anything too hard for me?" When Jonah was at the point of no hope, no survival, God stepped in again. "I called on the God of the universe, and he heard my cry." Verse 7, "As my life was slipping away, I remembered the Lord." Oh, I like that. "As my life was slipping away, I remembered the Lord." Hey, it's never too late to remember the Lord. I believe in deathbed conversions. God in his love and grace and mercy, no matter what you've lived and how you've lived, he is faithful. All he needs is for a heart cry to be heard from you, not just from your lips, from the depths of your heart. "And my earnest prayer went out to you in your holy temple." Some that within the sound of my voice today or this week, some of you need to remember God. Because in your circumstances and by your lifestyle, you've all but deserted him, all but forgotten him, and you're into this mode, I'm a believer, but I'm not living like it. Well, that's a step if we admit it. In good times, it's easy to grab the blessing of God and go. See you later. Be back when I need help again. I know you're there. If I need you, I'll put you on the shelf until next time. But in the meantime, I know you say go, but I'm going to go the opposite way. I'm going to do it my way. And yet when we mess up by doing it our way, God in his love and mercy still meets us where we are when we cry to him. Listen, even when we knew better. That ought to encourage somebody. You knew better, but you did it anyway. Jonah knew better, but he did it anyway. But God met him in that place. And God said, "I'm not done with you." Verse 8 says, "Those who worship false gods, so apparent in our world, turn their backs on all God's mercy." I don't know about you. I don't want to turn my back on God's mercy. Do you? I want to turn around and face him. Jonah goes back into the man of God prophetic mode, and he declares this truth. He's giving all of us a serious warning, and I know I'm paraphrasing words, but it's like, whatever you do, don't do what I did. Don't run away from God. Run to God. Don't neglect him. Don't disobey him. But wherever you are, cry out to him, and he'll hear your cry. Jonah was filled with fear and all kinds of things. He made bad choices, but it still brought him eventually to a place of sacrifice and surrender to the will of God. I just want to tell you today, if you're on the run, that it's a bad deal to ever trade the ever-present pursuing love of God for such temporary things that this world has to offer. Has anybody found it to be true? You may be holding on to these things, thinking that they in themselves will bring you happiness or joy or significance, but here's the problem. They're really holding on to you just like the seaweed wrapped around Jonah's head. They've got a hold on you. So like a text I got in the last couple weeks on a Saturday basically says, get the eternal things in first and squeeze the things that aren't around that. Got it? Don't fill your life with temporal things. Fill your life with the eternal things, and then let the others fill in any space. Verse 9, I'm just about done. Is anybody glad for the Bible's rawness and honesty and the hope-filled stories? Huh? This is a wonderful story of hope. Verse 9a, "But I will offer sacrifices to you with songs of praise. I will fulfill all my vows." Hey, you know what happened in that unlikely dark place? He had a heart change. His no became a great big yes. He said yes to the will of God. Oh, and God responded, "It's too late. You've blown it." No. He said, "I was waiting for you to say that, to pray that. I don't know. Once again, his vow maybe went something like this: Lord, and this is from our heart as well, when you speak, I'll obey and listen. I'll go where you want me to go. I'll do what you want me to do. I'll keep my promises to you. When you say here, I'll come here. I'll do it with joy and worship in my heart. Your praises will always be in my mouth. When God puts something in your heart, on your heart, you need to make it good. You need to do it. Yeah. I think sometimes when we have prompts that are spirit prompts in our life and we don't really want to do it, maybe it's God calling us to an outrageous act of generosity. It's like, what do you do? Blame that on the devil? He doesn't want you to be like Jesus. He's gonna fight that. If God puts it on your heart, just step in, step up, and do it. That's a takeaway. 9b says this: for my salvation comes from the Lord. What's the word? Is that true? I don't know how dark your place is, but there is salvation, there's hope, but it's a one source hope. God Almighty. You're doing the right thing. You got up and you're running, but you're running in the wrong direction. You need to run, but you need to run into his arms of love. Maybe religion has taught you that you will find judgment. But even Steph's testimony today, and I love this ministry starting. No, that her and others have a testimony that we came running into God's arms of love and that through as expressed through God's people, and that was a life-changing experience for us. Yes? Boy, if God ever had a right to be judgmental, he could have just nailed his hide to the wall, but he didn't. Don't you think we better take a clue about that in his church? If we're going to represent him. For salvation comes from the Lord alone. He had nothing to offer except he had everything to offer because that was himself. He could contribute nothing to his rescue and salvation operation except surrender. And that's what we can do. He was alone, seemingly. Totally dependent on God. And that's what he realized. Salvation comes from God alone. Ephesians 2:8 says it. God saved you by his grace when you believed. Does anybody remember your belief moment? You confess with your mouth, believe in your heart the Lord Jesus. And you can't take credit for this. You believe, but God did the rest. It's a gift from God. Salvation is not a reward for the good things we have done, so none of us can boast about it. For we are God's masterpiece. He has created us anew in Christ Jesus so we can do the good things he planned for us long ago. Our motivation is no longer us. It's God and his glory. Father, bring glory to your name. Salvation is a gift from God in any and every form. Nothing we can bring to it other than ourselves. It costs God his only son to provide it. We can be saved because of it. Jonah knew it. He came to know it and truly believe it. We must know it too. And we'll pick up next week, verse 10. Then the Lord ordered the fish to spit Jonah out onto the beach. He probably did some serious ground kissing and hugging at that point, don't you think? No matter where you may be today, God's great love and grace is pursuing you. His stubborn love, I wrote in the margin, his stubborn love is pursuing you. Whenever you call on the name of the Lord, he will answer and you'll be saved. Your circumstance may not, but you will be. And we're talking eternal destiny because God's word still rings true. He loved the world, you and me, so much that he gave his one and only son so that everyone who believes in him, cries out to him, will not perish but have eternal life. Amen? So here's the message of this movement of Jonah's life. His goodness is running after you. You can't outrun it. Will you let his goodness overtake you and catch you? With my life laid down, I surrender now. I give you everything. That's the key. Amen. I'm going to invite you to stand, if you will, if you can. I'm going to pray, and I've so appreciated the resurgence in our altar and stairs usage, and man, these are just appropriate time. God's so faithful to speak, and the best time to respond is now, and man, the altar's a great place to come alone, come together, groups, sit, kneel, stand, whatever. We always have prayer assistance available, but you're welcome to pray alone too. We'll give you space. But would you just say, Holy Spirit, show me where I am exactly, and could you restore within me hope that my salvation comes from God alone? I've been looking for answers and running hither and yon, but Lord, my hope is in you. You're the source of my salvation. I'm crying out to you. And Lord, these are precious people that you love, that you gave your son for, you died for, everyone within the sound of my voice. Your plans or purpose, as long as we have life and breath, we have not served our purpose fully in our generation. You're not ready for us to fall asleep. We've got your work to do, and we want to be about the Father's business. So I pray for some today that have never said yes to you in a saving relationship. They've been trying to be good enough, right enough, religious enough, and go through all the hoops, but they've never said, Jesus, come into my heart, be my Savior. Save me from myself and my sin. I know I've made horrible choices, and I knew better. I've known the truth, but I've gone in the opposite direction. But I'm coming back to the heart of worship. It's all about you today, right here, right now. Others who have been on the run, like Jonah, they used to be in close relationship, but the things of this world that are here today and gone tomorrow have just crowded you out, and they're far, far, and wondering how in the world they got to the bottom of the sea from where they once were, but you are there, and you're calling us by name. So may we simply respond, help. I can't fix me. I need you. As we sang, I need you more than I ever have before. Show us your love and power and grace and mercy in ways that we've never seen it or understood it before. And may all of us know that there's no place too far, too deep, too dark beyond the reach of your love and grace. And I pray it confidently and expectantly in the name of Jesus.